Semanov, and he received also many awards. In particular, in 2007, he was the recipient of the Centennial Fellowship from the AMS, and in 2009, he obtained the von Neumann Fellowship from the Institute of Advanced Study. He's working on combinatorial group theory and representation theory of discrete groups, and today he will speak about finitely generated groups with controlled co-algebraic completions.
Essentially, you get something like 2n multiple elements from the field, but you have to remember that you can still permute them, so you have to torsion by symmetry. And of course you can like do it a little bit better, but like I think this is like the best form. Now if you have a free group, things are a little bit more messy. It's not so easy to even describe what it is, because if you have one matrix, you can conjugate it to the other one, then you can still do something with the other matrix, and it's not so clear. If you have two free group on two generators and you're looking for two-dimensional representations, then actually what you get is something which is inside five-dimensional space. It's pretty easy to describe, it's very explicit, it's an open set, and everything is determined by the trace of the generators, the determinants of the generators, and by the trace of the product of the generators. And there are like a lot of explicit computations which people can do. And one nice thing about this example is that like some algebra associated with character variety is actually going to be a free algebra from these five polynomials, and you can do a lot of computations by the explanation. Okay. So what I care about is like what are the dimensions of these character varieties, and like you have two extremes. One extreme is when everything is breaks up into points and the group is rigid. So the character variety is a bunch of points, and you only have finite representations in each degree. Now, if the group is not rigid, it's very easy to see that like it's going to be bounded below by some linear function. And it's bounded above by something which comes from the free group, which is going to be a conductive function. So, what I'm going to talk today is, okay, a little bit fancy construction to essentially show the following. If you have any function which is between linear and quadratic, plus some mild conditions, which I'm not going to describe, you can find the finely generated group such that the dimensions of the character varieties are exactly incoming from the sequence. Okay, so what are some of the tools which come up here? One is representations of higher-rank arithmetic groups, and I even don't know what is the definition of arithmetic groups, so I'm only working with stuff like S, O, and Z. And one thing which is well known is that this group is rigid, and you don't really have that many representations. However, it's extremely difficult to count how many representations you have, even approximately. The reason is that most of the representations come from finite portions of the group, and you have a lot of finite portions which appear, and their representation theory is not completely clear. So you have to involve like tons of things in order to estimate them. People have done a lot of work on this, and I'm just saying like the answers are extremely long, extreme, and you have to do a lot of messy computations. Like there is no way you can avoid them. Okay, so actually one thing I'm going to use, and I'm going to try to explain a little bit later how this thing comes in with 26.2, is that this group is not only rigid, it's something that's called super rigid. And this means that if you have a representation of this group, then it's essentially factors to a representation of the ambient algebraic group. Right? Of course, you have to modify it a little bit, you have to allow like finite index stuff and so on, but like, you know, there are technical things. Okay, so what is one way to approach this kind of problem? And this is more or less like a range, which is not really anything else. You can just take all this information and package it into one object, and this is like so-called algebraic condition of the group. What you do is like you really take all the representations, you take their images, take the exposure, and like put them in one huge object. Which is a little bit messy, and you don't really want to work with it. And here is one example. If you start with like Z, which is like one of the simplest groups you can think about, then when you take the power of the completion, you're going to get something which is like pretty big. So first you get like the profile completion, which is product of PI. Okay, that's, it depends what you think, but that's like reasonably small object you can understand. Then you have unipotent representations which are coming from the additive group of the field. And then you have this huge thing, which is like product over elements in the field of multivector group. And this is actually coming from the fact that you have a lot of same simple representations, which are indexed by essentially field elements. And this really gives you this huge product. And this product tells you more or less that the dimension of the representation variety of degree 1 is 1. Because you have one-dimensional groups, and you have product of them which is indexed by something like a one-dimensional variety. In some sense, the point is like, this is like a convenient object, it's nothing else. And one question which I want to think about, which is like, there is no way I can answer it, or anyone can answer it, is, suppose that you're given a algebraic group, so something which can be obtained as limited algebraic groups in this way, can you find actually a finitely generated group such that like, it arises this algebraic condition? And of course, the answer is like, not always, like there are obvious obstructions which you need to satisfy. So your group is finitely generated, so this completion is topologically finitely generated in the correct topology, so you need this, there is no way you can do that. But you need a lot of other things. So here is one thing which is also relatively easy to see. So if your pro-algebraic groups, a group maps onto k or k star, this means that like you have some one-dimensional representation which will be infinite image. But this means that your group has to map onto Z. And therefore, the whole pro-algebraic completion has to contain this huge stuff which is coming from the pro-algebraic completion of Z. Okay, now let's show something similar, but it's a little bit more tricky. Now, suppose that you have not like k or k star in the pro-algebraic completion, but you have infinitely many torsion groups of different sizes. So now, if you have a lot of torsion, the only way to obtain a lot of torsion is if you have a torsion free part, and you have exactly the same argument. So in some sense, these are some kind of trivial obstructions, and like, they are not too difficult to understand. But here is one obstruction which is like way more messy, and it's much more mysterious because it doesn't tell you what has to be there, it tells you a big part of what has to be there. So suppose that your algebraic group, or the profiling part of it, maps onto SL3 of a bunch of different finite fields. Then what you can conclude is that you have to map onto the corresponding algebraic group, and you also have to map to a bunch of others SL3 of different finite fields. But you cannot say that you have to map to all of them, but you have to map on almost all of them. Okay, so this is something which it falls from the so-called strong approximation property. Really, what you prove is that the first condition implies that the group has infinite image inside SL3K, or suite of Rochelle's homomorphism, and from there you just push a lot of things into computation. Okay, so in some sense, what I'm going to talk about is that these obstructions are in some sense obstructions which are coming from fixed rank. So this is like a bunch of rank 2 quotients, and like in rank 2, if you have something, then also should have something else in rank 2. But what I want to say is that if you go to unbounded rank, there are no like similar obstructions. So let me try to be a little bit more precise. And this is something which is like actually a big stepping stone towards like what I was going to do, and like in some sense explain the construction. Suppose that you have sequence of rings such that like there are a reasonable number of generators, then you can find the finitely generated group such that the pro-algebraic completion is essentially coming from the pro-algebraic completion of this SLK, so in different things. The key thing here is that the rank has to grow. So k has to go from any one bound to infinity. And so, as I said, like, I really don't want to try to explain like exactly what is the pro-algebraic completion of a group like SLK and k, because it's getting a little bit messy. A little bit later I'm going to mention something in this direction, but I'm going to start cheating and it's going to be completely hidden. So this thing is actually precise and not cheating here. Okay. Okay. So what are the tools which come into this book? So one thing is representation of chivalry groups. And again, I'm only going to deal with stuff like SLK over some links. And suppose that you have a representation, a five-dimensional representation. And one thing we observed with Mark Spear is that if you look at like the root subgroup, so all the elementary matrices with non-zero entry in one two place, take their images under the homomorphism and take the Zariski closure, what you get is some algebraic variety. Okay, of course it's algebraic variety because it constricts the Zariski closure simply, that's not even the interesting part. But the interesting observation is that this variety has a structure for it. You have two algebraic maps, which go from A times A to A, which satisfy all the recursions. And all these maps are given by nice rational functions. Okay, where these maps actually come from, the addition is easy, because your homomorphism is a map from the root subgroup into G and K. The root subgroup is essentially an abelian group which corresponds to additive structure of the link. So when you push it, then the group multiplication is going to correspond to the addition of the link, and it's going to give you additive structure. Now, if you want to get the multiplicative structure, you have to play a little bit with commutators, but it's not that hard if you're really using like defining relations. And there is another observation that what you get is that the representation is going to factor to a representation of SLK over this link, which is like not clear exactly what it is, but it's something which like you can draw and study. Okay, so we're trying to figure out what kind of links you can obtain in this construction. So this is a nice definition. So you take a link and you call it algebraic link if it's a variety with two rational maps satisfying the usual axioms. And this theorem, which actually goes back to Greenberg in the 60s, but I was not aware of it, with Mark, we put it in a very special case of the field being complex numbers because we are lazy. And Timur Rapinchuk actually did all the details and did it carefully. So if you have an algebraic link, it's going to be an algebra. Of course, you have to know a bunch of like small things like finite extensions and all kinds of things, but the core of this link has to be an algebra. So you have a pretty transparent structure which might more as you can understand. And what this thing more or less implies is that if you have a representation of SLKR, after going to a finite index subgroup which corresponds to the fact that like this thing is not an algebra but it's a Victorian algebra, then your representation is going to factor to some algebraic representation of this algebra, or at least the SLK over this algebra. Okay, so there is one thing I want to stress here, is that this is true only in characteristic zero. If you go to positive characteristic, things are extremely messy and it's not clear exactly what is the answer. I think that if you make little assumptions, which are like a bit technical, then you can prove that algebraic link is virtually a quotient of an algebra of truncated bit vectors. So you have some structure, but it's not so transparent, and it's a little bit more messy, and then I don't know how to switch. Okay, so why this thing is useful? For example, this gives like a very nice proof of Margulis' supergene for a group like SLKZ. And I have to admit that I'm very stupid because I have completely missed this proof, and I was talking to Tarek Yolanda, who actually showed me that, oh, this machinery actually gives this thing for free, and like you don't have to work for it. Okay, so what it is? Suppose that you have a representation of SLKZ into some G-line of the field, build the corresponding algebraic link, and the previous theorem says that like up to finite index, this algebraic link is an algebra. But what kind of algebra this thing can be? So your root subgroups are cyclic, so they're generated essentially by one and by two just adding them. So therefore this algebra has to be generated by one, and it has to be either zero-dimensional or one-dimensional. So you don't really have any choice. So if the algebra is zero-dimensional, then essentially your representation needs to have a finite image, and you're more or less like boom. In the second case, the algebra is SLK, so the algebra corresponds to the group SL over the field, and you're going to get like super rigidity that your representation coincides with some algebraic representation of this group onto a finite index seven. Okay, what else you can do with this thing? So this is something which I think Igor Gabrysh is going to talk a little bit more I think on Tuesday, and I'm pretty sure he's going to be more careful and he's not going to cheat like I don't think. So this is answering a question by Burrell and Tietz from the 60s, and they ask a very strange question. So suppose that you're given two algebraic groups on different fields, and you're looking for homomorphisms between them, but you completely forget about the algebraic structure. You're looking for homomorphisms as abstract groups, and which do not have to visit the algebraic structure. And he says that this is a very unnatural question, but it really tells you that even though you completely understand the finite-dimensional representation of algebraic groups, this is if you assume that like your representations preserve the structure, the algebraic structure. If you don't preserve the structure, right, things are getting completely crazy, like you don't really know what it is. So what Igor proved is that, and this was more or less conjecture when we were with it, is that if you take any such abstract homomorphism, it's built out of two pieces. One piece is a real homomorphism from your field, your defining field, into some algebra over the other field. And the other one is a linear algebraic representation of the group SOK over this algebra into n by n matrices. And everything is more or less obtained by composing the algebraic representation with the induced representation from this string homomorphism. And okay, you actually need all these kinds of pieces because like obviously all these kinds of things are going to give you after homomorphisms, and like the difficult part is to prove that there is nothing else. So in the original paper, well, we did prove this thing only in the case of real numbers. A little bit later, it was proved by Gabrysh and Lipschitz in the case when the group is close to semi-simple, and I really don't want to be technical here, but you know, this actually gives you something which is like a complete answer to this question. So one thing which you can push off a bit, and I'm going to explain it in the next slide, is that more or less you can replace the first algebraic group with any algebraic group defined over any link, and you're going to have something like similar result, but it's going to be a little bit more technical. So let me try to sketch what kind of technical things you're going to get. Okay, so this is a very easy one. Suppose that you have a link, you look at the group SL K over the thing, and you want to compute and consider the character varieties. So if the dimension is small, the character variety is going to be a point. So you only have the trivial representation, there is nothing else you can have. And if the dimension is big, then the character variety is going to, the dimension of character variety is going to grow linearly, and you more or less can estimate the coefficient very precisely. And what is the reason? And just plug this into the machinery, and what you need to do is you need to describe the all possible algebraic links which are going to come with this construction. So there are two things you have to do. So you know that the algebraic links you get are virtual in algebra, so since you're considering points over the character variety, everything has to be same simple, so they're commutative, so they're virtually some power of the field. So what you need to do is you need to bound the index of this virtual stuff and the size of these algebras. And that's not very difficult, like this is more or less like a standard computation. And then what you need to consider is like onboarding into your base suit. And you just need to realize that this is nothing else but the spectrum of the link once you modify it in the correct way, and this is clearly the dimension minus one, because I usually consider all my links to be like defined over C, and like you have like some part of the spectrum coming from the branch, which you ignore because you tensor, etc. Okay, so what is you get from here? You get a pretty good understanding of the top-dimensional component of the character graph. So this is provided that your link is sufficiently big and like you actually get like varieties of positive dimension. And the reason is that the virtual stuff is going to contribute to components which have smaller dimensions, so you can completely ignore them. So at the end, you see that the top-dimensional component is going to be essentially the spectrum of the link to some power. And of course, you have to modify corresponding symmetric group and so on. It's always easy to understand. Okay, so now you can package this thing in something. And one way to package this thing connected with algebraic transmission is to say that essentially everything you're proving is that the algebraic transmission of a group like SLK over the ring is nothing else but SLK over the algebraic transmission of the ring, which you have to define in the correct terms, but it's not very difficult to do it. And then you just formally think of matrices over this thing. So now let's apply this thing to the group Z. And what you get is you get something which is like very nice. So the pro algebraic completion of the ring C consists of the finite part, which is the profinite completion, plus the field itself. So you put it here, and you get that the pro algebraic completion of the group S, L, and Z consists of two parts. One is the profinite part, the other one is S of the open field. And if you think a little bit, this actually combines the theorem in a very clear form. So this combines like over subgroup property, saying that any finite tilted subgroup of S O and Z is a common subgroup, so it comes from something in the Z. And it also tells you the Magui superimmunity because like the only representations, algebraic representations, needs to factor to the component of this group, connect component of this group, which is like the group S O K, and there is nothing else. Okay, so now how you can use these two things and combine them to actually obtain something, or just like close our constriction. So first, let me try to construct the groups with like more restricted properties, but forget one important condition that they're finitely generated. Because without finitely generated, if you allow yourself to do non-finitely generated groups, things are much easier and a little bit more clean to explain. Okay, so what's happening here? So one thing you can realize is that if you have a group which breaks as a direct product or direct sum of several groups, you can use your knowledge for the character varieties of each of the pieces to get good enough information for the character variety of the product. So maybe, for example, if you want to compute the dimensions, like you can just write some formulas and everything is going to follow more explicitly. But really, the idea behind everything is that if you have a product of groups, a reducible representation of a product is just a tensor product of a reducible of each factor. And then you just package everything together and push it into. So this is fine if you look at like sums of like 2, 3, or 5 copies. But you can push this thing to infinite direct sums, and nothing is going to change, provided that you guarantee that by table things are going to work together. So for example, you want to make sure that like most of your groups do not have a lot of representation in small degree, because otherwise you can combine all of them together and you're going to get like a big mess which you cannot really see how to deal with. But if you put some kind of nice conditions which allows you that this thing does not happen, then knowing representations of each of the pieces is going to give you a representation of like everything. So one way to state this thing is that if you have infinite direct sum, if you want to consider Roche ray completion, or actually any LA completion. This is just the direct product of the completions of each device. So you just put them together. Okay, so now, more or less we are done with. We now can just take all the groups. So all the groups are going to be of the form I said before. So these are SOKs over different links. So in my case, the links are going to be just polynomials and several variables. I take all the direct sum over different k's. You get some big group, and now you can estimate that the dimension of the character varieties are exactly given by the number of variables of the stuff you put in inside this construction. So, what is really happening here? Each of the groups, so each of the factors in this product, is going to have linear growth of the dimensions. However, this growth is going to start at a different point, so it's going to start at the dimension k. And when you want to go and get like a product of a representation of the big group, it's going to factor to some finite product, because like later factors do not have any representation of small degree. So now you can start computing as a group. And now what you can see is that if you impose some mild condition on the sequence, so the character variety coming from the last component is going to be much bigger than all this stuff you can obtain from the previous one. Therefore, you can see that the top dimensional component of the character variety is going to come from the corresponding group and is going to have the greatest dimension of the dimension you want to call. Okay, so one thing I really want to stress is that this is cheating. So you can obtain a group, but this group is definitely not finitely generated. So in some sense, like, you're not answering any question which is semi-reasonable. Like, if you ask the question like, can you find like some discrete group with like given pre-algebraic completion, the answer is of course you can do it. Like, take the pre-algebraic group, think of it as a discrete group, and you're done. So you want to make something a little bit more, and like you have to just working in the category of not finitely generated groups, which is not really a good point, but you have to do something else. However, this is like actually a very good starting point. And what you can do is you can use some tricks to make everything finitely generated. So these tricks are a little bit technical. I'm just trying to outline some ideas which come there. I'm probably not going to get technical stuff, but this is really built on some work I did with Nick Nikolov like maybe 10 years ago, and it's a very nice little construction. Okay, so what do we have? We have this kind of infinite direct sum of groups. This is sitting inside the infinite direct product. Of course, the infinite direct sum is not finitely generated. There is obvious things why this cannot be. But in many cases, like the infinite product is the logically finitely generated. So what you can do is you can try to take a dense subgroup, which is finitely generated. And then, if you have a dense subgroup, then any representation of the big product is going to give you a representation of this dense subgroup. And what you're going to get is essentially a lower bound for the character varieties. Because you can construct enough representations which are coming from this infinite product. So there is some kind of technical condition which you really need for all things to work. So I really want to consider groups which are not only dense, but actually contain the direct sum. So this is a little bit stronger with density, but it gives a slightly better control of what's going on. So, one thing I want to stress is that if you have a group like this, typically gamma over this infinite direct sum is going to be very close to a free group. So therefore, you can actually have a lot of representations of this group which are not continuous with respect to the natural topology. So these are representations which you cannot extend from the discrete group to the infinite product. So this is going to give you extra pieces in the character variety, which are very difficult to control, and like essentially you have no idea what's going on there. So what you need to do is you need to avoid that. Okay, so how to avoid that? This is something which is not ideal, going back maybe 30 years ago to talk like in there. What you do is you construct something which you call poison subgroups. So these are groups like you know that they cannot have any finite dimensional representation. So under any finite dimensional representation, these groups have to die. They need to have to be triggered. And so this was really introduced by Formic in there, and in the 80s they used this thing to prove that the automorphism of a group is not a linear group. So you cannot really have a faithful linear representation by just constructing a single poison subgroup somewhere. Okay, so now you can get like this thing kind of packaged into a very simple demo. Suppose that you have a group which is sitting in between these two, on the direct and the direct product, and assume that like somehow inside your group you have forced enough poison subgroups which generate the quotient. So now, if you have a representation of this group, okay, so these poison subgroups, they have to die under this representation. Therefore, in some sense, your representation is going to just be a representation of the direct sum, because everything else is going to be forced to disappear. So what you get is that the algebraic completion, that any representation, you can extend it to the infinite product, even though you have a bunch of very complicated quotients which like you don't even understand, right? You just build it so that it doesn't have any reasonable representation. And one way to say this thing is this theory says that the completion of your group is the same as the product of the completions. So there is a natural map between the completions, and this map is actually an isomorphism. And this essentially does everything if you can reduce this thing. I really don't want to go into the technical stuff how to produce it. So one idea of this thing is to work a little bit with matrices over non-commutative links and like big suitable links and sublinks so that like, you're actually going to get a bunch of poison signals. But I really don't want to get into this kind of stuff. Okay, so as I said, I'm going to be relatively quick, so everything I wanted to say is, as I said, it's like not a very difficult question, and like I definitely don't know any applications of this question, so I don't think it's like extremely important. But for me, this is something which like explains what I'm doing. It explains what kind of tricks and machinery I'm usually using. Thank you very much.
Are there some questions or comments?
Yeah. Can your group of superrigidity be extended to uniformizers?
No. So this kind of proof really uses that like your group is split. So you need to have enough unipotents in the group. So I think you really need to have a group of two and two, at least, in order to apply this machine. So one thing, so Uri Baller and Art Hormann like actually in some sense inspired by this proof, and they tried to digest it, and they like took this proof and took it completely apart and produced a new proof that like what this have are super rigid, and I think Art Hormann is going to talk about this maybe on Monday. If I look at this their proof, I really don't see any resemblance to what we're doing. But both of them claim that like, they're inspired by this thing and like, they just use this thing as a starting point. Maybe you have to ask them how to notice the connection.
Yeah. Similar question. So, this construction or this algebra structure on A, so for SL3 it's kind of clear, but what happens when it's a plenty group? Do you have these long roots and the short roots? Does it work?
It's more or less the same thing. Okay, I think Igor cryptography should be straight an expert on this thing. So, so if you have a big enough security group, then you can embed SOP there and try to produce SOP using, say, the log rules in order to get the structure and try to go for it. If you have something like SP4 where you don't have enough room to put SOP, then you have to be a little bit more careful. You have to ensure that something is divisible by 2, and if you have one card or more, you can do it. It's just getting more technical. But it's the same idea.
Other questions? Well, if not, let's thank Professor Kasparov again. Next talk will be at 5.